Let me introduce the next speaker, Andrea Tellini from Universidad Politécnica de Madrid. So he will talk about propagation for reaction diffusion systems in cylinder with general section and fast diffusion on the boundary. Thank
Okay,
you.
can you see the slides?
Yes, it's perfect.
Okay, thank you. Yes, so thanks to the organizers for the invitation and for the effort to organize this workshop. I'm very pleased to be here. So this work that I'm going to present today is related to some works that I did with Beniamino Bogofel, Luca Rossi, Tomas Giletti, and Enrico Valdinocci, and will be related to some propagation phenomena in reaction diffusion system with heterogeneities that I will describe later. In particular, it will be related to some eigenvalue approach to study the propagation. And in order to, for those who are not expert in propagation phenomena, I will start with the case of one reaction diffusion equation and see how the eigenvalue approach applies here, which is quite easy or easier to understand at least. So let's start with this equation, partial derivative of V minus D, Laplace V equal F of V, with D a positive diffusion coefficient, which is constant. And we are working in, as I said in the title, in a cylinder. So X would be the axial variable and Y will be the set of variables for the sections which belong to a bounded regular domain of Rn. Then we put, for the moment, homogeneous Neumann conditions, so no flux on the boundary, and we add an initial datum which is assumed to be compactly supported. As for the nonlinearity, we assume here the official KPP type, and by that I mean that it vanishes at 0 and 1. So in particular, the constants 0 and 1 are solutions of the equation and the boundary conditions. Okay. Also, I assume to be locally Lipschitz and differentiable at 0 with positive derivative at 0. Okay, and we will see what is the role of this positive derivative at zero. And then the thing of being Fischer KPP comes here with this monotonicity assumption of on the quotient f of v over v, which is assumed to be decreasing. So in particular, this implies that f prime of zero times v is greater than f of v for all positive v. Why that? Because if we pass this v dividing here, we have that. We have this quotient, and this quotient is decreasing, so it reaches its maximum at when v goes to zero. And when v goes to zero, this quotient converges to f prime of zero. Okay, so we have this inequality, which will appear later. And I start with a video. Say I'm not in a cylinder, I'm in a whole line. Let's see, however, what happens to get an idea of how the propagation of this solution occurs. So this is what happens. We started from an initially compactly supported initial datum, and we have two phenomena. One is that, here in the central part, we have convergence to one, which is the positive state. And however, far away, the solution is still close to zero. And we have this transition zone from regions where the solution is close to one, regions where the solution is close to zero, which moves in time. And we want to study how this transition zone moves asymptotically in time. And the concept to study this, the movement of these transitions is what is called asymptotic speed of propagation. So I hear what the mathematical formulation for this property. And I should mention the seminal works for this, the propagation of the Fischer KPP equation in cylinders, which are these by Beresticki and Nirenberg and Malherdi-Rochhofer. So let's see what, how can be the concept of asymptotic speed of propagation formulated. Okay, it consists of two properties. The first one here means that if we look at our solution with the axis, the axial variable, which increases linearly in time with the speed c greater than this quantity, twice square root of the diffusion coefficient time times the derivative at zero of the nonlinearity, then asymptotically in time we see zero. This means that if we move at speed c along the axis of the cylinder, we move faster than the solution because the solution has not converged to one yet. On the other hand, if we look inside, say for x smaller than times t, now with c smaller than the critical this critical quantity, which is the same as before, we converge to one asymptotically in time. And this means that now we have moved slower than the solution, okay, because we have converged to the positive equilibrium. So this critical quantity which separates the two behavior, and I denote it by CF, to recall the Fisher-KPP equation with F, with nonlinearity F, is called asymptotic speed of propagation. And what I'm going to show you next is how this quantity appears. So first of all, the linearized problem at V equals zero, so we replace the nonlinearity here with F prime of zero times V, plays an important role because of the assumption of the Fisher-KPP assumption, which implied this relation I mentioned before. Why? Because if we have solutions now of this linear problem, thanks to that inequality, they are super solution of the nonlinear problem. Okay, and if we are able to construct super solution which move at certain speed, being super solution of the nonlinear problem, which will allow us to obtain an upper bound for the speed of propagation. Okay, this is what I stated here. So a super solution moving with a certain speed give an upper bound for the speed of propagation. So let's study this linearized problem. And in particular, we look for a solution of this type. So an exponential profile decaying in the x variable, the variable of the axis of the cylinder, times a function depending on the other variables. And the exponential profile moves with the speed c. Okay, so if we plug these ansatz in the linear equation, we arrive to this elliptic problem, because the exponential here appears everywhere, can be canceled. And so since we want V to be positive, we observe that here the quantity minus C alpha has to be the principal eigenvalue of this operator in the domain omega, the section of the cylinder with Neumann boundary conditions. So this is what I've stated here. The sign, so C times alpha has to be minus the principal eigenvalue of this eigenvalue problem. Okay, and as I said, so C is the speed of the of this super solution, is C equal minus the principal eigenvalue divided by alpha. And this C gives an upper bound for the speed of propagation. So if we want to get, say, the best upper bound, we want to minimize this quotient minus lambda f of alpha over alpha. And I just mentioned that the principal eigenvalue depends on alpha because we have this term here, d alpha squared appearing in the operator. Okay, and it turns out that the minimum of this quantity with alpha over alpha positive is not only the best optimal upper bound that we can obtain in this way, but it turns out to be precisely the speed of propagation. Okay? Because for C smaller than this minimum, we are able to construct subsolution that move with that speed C arbitrarily close to CF. Okay, so this is characterization of the speed of propagation in terms of the eigenvalue. And now let's see what is the value of such an eigenvalue in this simple case. Okay, if we look this eigenvalue problem, for example, if we put everything on the left-hand side, so we have now zero, which can be seen as zero times V, by the uniqueness of the principal eigenvalue, we see that it has to be minus D alpha squared minus F prime of zero. So minus the principal eigenvalue has to be this term here, the zero order term of the operator with sign. Okay, so the function we are interested in, minus lambda F over alpha, is explicit here, is D times alpha plus F prime of zero over alpha. And with elementary calculus, we can see that it has this behavior, the behavior that I have represented here. So it has a vertical asymptote for alpha going to zero. It behaves linearly at alpha going to infinity, and it has a unique minimum point, which can be explicitly computed. And the minimum value is twice square root of d f prime of zero, which was the speed of propagation. So this is how the speed of propagation can be explicitly computed in this simple case. Okay. And also, this approach works for heterogeneous F, okay, with F depending also on the Y variable. So it allows to treat more general situations. Okay, and now I pass to the case of systems. And the systems I will consider are what Beresticki, Rozoff, and Rossi in 2013 called the road field systems, which are systems of two coupled reaction diffusion equation set in two domains, which are one the boundary of the other. So assume that we are in a half plane now, which they call the field, where we have a diffusion, a density V, which obeys the Fischer-KPP equation we have considered before. And on the boundary of the half plane, so the horizontal line, we have another density, which diffuses with a possibly different coefficient, capital D, which actually will be of interest when it will be large, to model the fact that we have a fast diffusion on the road. The road is the way they call the horizontal line from the biological model they have in mind. And the coupling between the two domains is in the sense, part of V is allowed to pass from the field to the road, and part of U is allowed to pass from the road to the field. So this is described in terms of flux of V through the boundary, and the same but with opposite sign appears in the reaction diffusion equation for U. Okay, so this was the model they introduced, and their main result can be summarized as follows. There is an asymptotic speed of propagation in the x direction, the direction of the road, which I denote by CHP for half plane to recall what the domain is. It will appear later. And it proves that this speed coincides with the Fischer KPP speed of propagation if the capital D is smaller than or equal to twice small d. So if the diffusion on the boundary is not too large, then we have the same speed of propagation as in the homogeneous case. And by homogeneous case, I mean only the fact that we have the Fischer KPP equation. Instead, if the capital D, the diffusion on the boundary, is larger than this threshold, twice small d, then the speed of propagation is strictly larger than the one of the homogeneous case. And moreover, this, so we have that the speed of propagation is accelerated, or the speed is larger due to this heterogeneous diffusion on the boundary. And this enhancement can be made as large as we want if we take d going to infinity, because they prove that the speed behaves asymptotically as a square root of d of capital D. Okay, so in a subsequent work in collaboration with Rossi and Valdinoci, we consider a field which is no longer the half plane, but as bounded section. So here in the Planck case, we consider a strip where we put the Fisher-KPP equation, and on the boundary, which now represent two roads of fast diffusion, we put the equation we had before and the flux condition as before. So in principle, here U should be different from U tilde, but by symmetry, we can take U and U tilde to be the same. And we generalized also this planar setting to a higher dimensional one, where we considered a cylinder with fast diffusion on the boundary and faster than the diffusion in the interior. And these kinds of systems are also known in the literature as bulk for the interior surface system. Can you just comment that since we have U on a manifold, the correct diffusion operator is the Laplace-Beltrami operator, which generalizes the Laplacian on manifolds. And what we did here was to study the asymptotic speed of propagation in along the axis of the cylinder, which is the only unbounded direction. And I call it C-star seal. So seal here will refer to the cylinder with whose section is a ball. Okay. And I should mention also that in this study, we did not use the eigenvalue approach I described before for the Fisher-KPP equation, because since we have so since the section is a ball, and since F does not depend on Y, we could explicitly have the form of the eigenfunctions in the problem we have to study for the linearization, and this led to a different characterization of star based on the geometric intersection between two curves. Okay, so say the approach here was more precise and in a way easier than the eigenvalue approach, okay, and actually gave more information than what than the eigenvalue approach would give, okay, as we will see later, because now we enter in the framework where we use the eigenvalue approach, and this is what we did with Bogoselli and Giletti in this preprint of last year, where we consider, say, the same system as before, but now with heterogeneities of two types. First of all, the cylinder is no longer a cylinder with the section of a ball. So the section here is a general bounded regular domain of Rn. And we also allow dependence on Y for the reaction F. We put also reaction term on the boundary, G, also of official KPP type. And we put also a coefficient here, K, which could depend on Y in front of the exchange terms. Okay, so just mention, well, no, this I will do later. So what we want to study is, let's say, generalized results that we had obtained before for the case of the cylinder with the section, say with the section which was a ball, to this case of heterogeneity. And in particular, we will study the shape of the domain with a numerical study. Say, if I have time, that's what I will show in the last part. Okay. And study this heterogeneous problem with dependence on Y and with general section, we had to use the eigenvalue problem. So it is essentially an adaptation of the case for the for a single equation to the case of of a system. And so we look for, again, we study the linearization around U equals zero, V equals zero of the equation, because it will provide us with super solution. We look for super solution of exponential profile decaying in X and moving with a certain speed times certain positive functions, which leads to this eigenvalue problem now with for the systems. Okay, the difference is the system, and with respect to before to the situation before I presented for the Fisher-KPP equation, here, say if we put this term kappa times mu u to the left, to the right hand side, this condition can be seen as a Robin type condition of non-homogeneous type. So the boundary conditions for the eigenvalue problem are also different. And it's, this makes the situation more involved. So as before, the relation between the C, the speed at which the super solution move, and the eigenvalue is this one, C times alpha is equal to minus the principal eigenvalue, C is equal minus lambda over alpha, and we want to minimize this quantity. And the point here is that we are not able, due to the heterogeneities and to the shape of the domain, which is arbitrary, obtain a precise value for the eigenvalue. But still, if we do a scaling of the variables, we are able to transform this problem, or better, the weak formulation of this problem into a self-adjoint one. And so we are able to write the eigenvalue as the minimum of the Rayleigh quotient for this weak problem. Okay, and with this expression, we are able to obtain several properties of the speed of propagation. Okay, I think that I did not mention here, I go back, sorry, to the hypothesis on FNG, is that we do not necessarily assume that the derivative with respect to V and U to be positive at zero. Okay, so it could be negative, at least at some points of the domain. And this represents from the biological point of view of population dynamics that there are regions of the domain where mortality could occur. Okay, and this will appear now. First of all, we determine some properties of the eigenvalue using, I insist, the weak formulation. And so we prove that the eigenvalue depends continuously on alpha, it is even and concave. And if lambda at zero is negative, then the function which we want to study to determine the speed of propagation is positive and has a unique minimum point as in the graph I showed before. Okay, for the single equation. Now, this is the same for the system. And this condition, lambda of zero negative, is the condition which is necessary and sufficient for having invasion. And by invasion, I mean the existence of a positive steady state to which the solution asymptotically converges. Okay, because the fact of having mortality, low immortality, say does not ensure that we have such a positive steady state. So we have to determine when we have such a positive steady state, and this is precisely given by the sign of this principal eigenvalue. When this assumption does not hold, then the solution converges to the trivial 1, 0, 0 uniformly in the domain. And in this case, I speak conversely of extinction, so as an opposite to invasion. Okay, and we are able to give a sufficient condition for having this sign, which is related to this integral of the derivative of G, of the reaction G with respect to U, plus this combination with the exchange coefficient, involving the exchange coefficients, and the integral of the derivative with respect to V of the nonlinearity F. Okay, so this combination has to be positive. And this is, for example, easily checked if the derivatives are positive everywhere. Okay, so which was the assumption I did on the equation at the beginning. And moreover, we are able to do that if we have invasion, then there is an asymptotic speed of propagation, which I just denote by C star now, again, in the along the direction of the axis of the cylinder, and it can be characterized as the minimum of the function minus lambda of alpha, the principal eigenvalue of our eigenvalue problem divided by alpha. So again, we have this characterization, which will be useful to study the properties of the eigenvalue. And now I'm going to state at least some of these properties, which we are able to. And first of all, we study the dependence of the speed on the diffusion coefficient capital D on the boundary. So as D goes to zero, we are able to prove that if the equation in the interior, which was the Fisher KPP equation with F alone provides invasion, then the limit as d goes to zero of our speed converges to something, which this assumption holds true, the limit strictly smaller than the speed of propagation of the Fisher-KPP equation, okay, which now recall that it is heterogeneous. Okay, so it's not exactly the same twice the square root of d f prime of zero. Okay. Nevertheless, this condition, which involves the derivative of the reaction g at zero, and this condition on the principal eigenvalue of f, if f is homogeneous, so it does not depend on y, this condition reduces to the quotient of g prime of zero over f prime of zero to be smaller than two in the homogeneous case. And this condition was already obtained by Beresticki, Rozsoff, and Rossi in another work of 2013, so not the one that I mentioned before, say to guarantee that for small d, the speed is smaller than the one in the homogeneous case with only f. Okay. So this is the first part of the result with the limit for d going to zero. For d going to infinity, we are able to recover the behavior of the speed of propagation as the square root of d, asymptotically as d goes to infinity. So if we combine these two results, we think that there is a threshold of d because the speed depends continuously on d. So there is a threshold to have the speed greater than the speed of the equation corresponding to the equation in the interior of the cylinder. So for sufficiently large d, we have enhancement of the speed also in this situation. Now we want to study the monotonicity with respect to capital D. And this is quite tricky. If the domain is radial, so if we consider a ball or an annulus, so in particular we'll cover the case that I had studied with Rossi and Baldinucci, where we proved that the speed was increasing. So we recover that that result also now, not only for radial domains, but also for radial coefficients. So it is more general actually than the result we had obtained. And another type of radial domains, of course, are NLD. Okay, so in this case, the speed is monotone increasing. But if the domain is non-radial, so either because of the domain or because the coefficients are not radial, then if we look at the nominator in the Rayleigh quotient, we have two terms which depend on capital D and have opposite signs. Okay, so the monotonicity is not clear. So what happens is that in radial domains, this one here disappears because U is constant on the boundary if the domain is radial. Okay, so this term disappears, we have a precise sign for the a precise monotonicity of this numerator on capital D, which translates to a monotonicity for the principal eigenvalue and then on the speed of propagation. So non-radial case, the monotonicity is not clear, and indeed it may fail. We have an analytical example in which we have invasion, so the speed is positive for small d, but we have extinction for large d, so there must be some value of d for which the speed goes to zero, and so we have non-monotonicity, because that's to pass from positive values to zero, okay? But this analytical example is related to some mortality case, okay? But nevertheless, we construct a numerical example in which the speed is non-monotonic even with always positive speed. Okay, so we see that indeed monotonicity may fail. And then what we did is studying the limit, the behavior of the speed of propagation depending on the size of the cylinder. In what sense? What we do now is we fix a domain omega for the section, and we fix function f, g, and k, which are the nonlinearities and the term we put in front of the exchange terms. Okay. And what we do now is we rescale the domain by multiplying it by r and rescale the coefficients accordingly so that we they are defined in the corresponding reaction diffusion equations are defined in this new domain. Okay, and what happens is that when R goes to zero, the speed of propagation converges to this quantity, which recalls us a certain speed of propagation for a Fisher-KPP equation with diffusion capital D, so the diffusion on the boundary, and the average of the of the derivative of the nonlinearity at zero. So what happens is a kind of homogenization phenomenon. And instead, when R goes to plus infinity, what happens is that, well, we gave the proof for homogeneous coefficient, but it can be generalized to non-homogeneous one. What happens is that the speed now converges to the speed of the half plane, so the speed in an unbounded domain, because we can imagine the situation as follows. We lay the cylinder, say on the floor, and we let R goes to infinity, what happens is that the cylinder becomes more and more flat. And so this kind of continuous dependence of the cylinder converges to a half plane, say, and this is translated to the dependence on the corresponding speed of propagation. So the speed of propagation of the cylinder converges to the speed of propagation on the half space, the speed of the half plane can be shown to be the same in a half space, so in higher dimensions. Okay. And now, in the last minutes, a couple of minutes, I just want to mention the question of the dependence on the speed on the shape of the domain. First of all, I have to say that what we did now is purely numerical, and it's based on the fact that since we have the variational characterization of the eigenvalue, we are able to perform the shape derivative of the principal eigenvalue. And so we're able to study the dependence of the speed also on the shape. And what comes out from our simulation is that the disks play a key role in the optimization, let's say shape optimization. So this is the results of one of our simulation. We start with this kind of domain, and as the optimization process goes on, we see that the domain converges to a disk. And now, if we want to study the role of the disk, we have to study, say, the monotonicity of the speed of propagation in the case of a cylinder with section, which is a ball, with dependence on R. And we have different behavior. I go just quickly. What we did in our work is generalizing the monotonicity proved. That I had proved with Rossi and Baldinucci to the case when we have a reaction also on the boundary. And so, the monotonicity depends on whether the interior is more convenient for the propagation or the boundary, or if we have an opposite, if the boundary and the interior play an opposite role. Okay? So we can have this kind of monotonicity for the speed of propagation in a cylinder with a ball. And this translates to the fact that the shape optimization problem might be either ill-posed because the domain finds, since the domain has to resemble a disk, and for example, in this case, the speed for disks is increasing with the radius. What happens if we maximize the disk, if we want to maximize the speed, the domain will try to be larger and larger, a larger and larger disk. So the optimum is not achieved. And on the other hand, if we minimize the speed of propagation, the domains will try to shrink and will degenerate to one or several points. Okay, so, and I think I'm over with my type, just to comment that when we have opposite behavior of the interior of the boundary, here we have a maximum for the speed of propagation. So in the unconstrained optimization problem for the shape. With our numerical simulation show that the domain converges to this optimal disk with this optimal radius. But when we have constrained optimization, so either an area or perimeter constraint, the effect of converging to this disk depend on the size of this constraint, so whether it is smaller than the constraint corresponding to this critical disk or it is strictly larger. Okay, so thanks, sorry for this couple of minutes I've taken more, and thank you for the attention. I'm sorry the last part has been a little fast, but it just, that's what I could do. Thanks again
to you all.